This is the Beaver Nation Network.
Good evening. My name is Lydia Travis. I'm the Director of Athletics here at the City College of New York. I would like to welcome everyone and thank you for joining us at our inaugural basketball tip-off banquet. We are very excited for this night. The staff has been working hard to put this together, so we hope you enjoy. This night is not only about looking toward the future of City College basketball, but we're also having an opportunity and honor to be able to take a look at the past and celebrate our history. With this being the 70th anniversary of our 1949-50s NCAA Men's Basketball Championship and NIT Championship, we are thrilled to have everyone here this particular year to kick off this tradition.
Michael Williams, I'm the head women's basketball coach and strength and conditioning coach. I am super excited to be part of CCNY. I said this in my interview, this was one of my dream jobs. And I am so fortunate to be here, thankful for Lydia, Karina, Jamie, and everybody that was on the hiring committee that hired me. I have an amazing group of young women who show up every day. We have 7 a.m. practices, 8 to 10 p.m. practice, and they just work their tail off. They're getting better day by day, and they're just great people off the court. My staff and I are also doing an amazing job recruiting, making sure that we upgrade the team year by year. So we're excited to say that we have 4 players who verbally committed, and hopefully we get another 8. So we just keep on adding to this amazing CCNY basketball program, the college, and everything that the school has to offer.
It was a team that was extraordinary in many respects. You know, we're talking about 1949, just 2 years after Jackie Robinson had integrated Major League Baseball, at a time when the NBA had 0 black players. The NBA had not yet integrated. The CCNY Beavers comprised entirely minority players. Every member of the team was either Jewish or black. 11 Jewish players, 4 African American players on that team. They were a group of smart, tough, scrappy kids from the boroughs of New York, none of them rich. And together they achieved something that nobody else in history had ever achieved, and they were celebrated from one end of New York to the other. And I just want to spend about 2 minutes to finish up by talking about our honored guest tonight, Floyd Lane. Floyd Lane spent years trying to get into the NBA. All of the players were blacklisted for life from the NBA. He was never able to get in. He tried to prove to the world that he was a good, honorable, decent man, as he is. And finally, in the 60s, he gave up his dream and devoted himself to children and began working in community centers in the South Bronx all through the worst years of New York's history, the 60s and the 70s, trying to get kids off of drugs, away from violence, out of gangs, trying to help them further their education. When a kid wanted to go on to college, Floyd spoke to college administrators, spoke to athletic directors, found scholarship money for tuition and books. He estimates that he helped 400 kids get into college. Other people say the number was much higher than that. One of the kids for whom he became a kind of surrogate father was a kid known in the neighborhood as Tiny. We know him as Nate Tiny Archibald, who went on to have a Hall of Fame career in the National Basketball Association. Floyd also continued coaching. And in 1974, this amazing thing happened. The position of head coach at City College came open, and Floyd applied for that job. He had applied for that same job 4 years earlier and hadn't gotten it, but this time was different. 23 years earlier, Floyd had been escorted from City College by 2 detectives, and now he was returning to City College to be the head coach of the basketball team. And they had a press conference at Wingate, the Wingate gym. And at that press conference, Floyd said, his voice breaking, "We were kids who made a mistake, and we paid a heavy price for that mistake. For me, that incident really put my feet on the ground. It taught me about adversity and led me to dedicate myself to kids so that they wouldn't make the same kind of mistake and pay the same terrible price." And then he said, "Words cannot describe my feelings at this time. The shortest distance between two points is a straight line, and I've traveled in a wide circle, but I finally got back home." That home for Floyd, as it is for so many of us, was City College. And it's so fitting that we're here today at City to honor Floyd and the rest of his team. It was 70 years ago this month, November of 1949, when they played their first game together and started their long path to history. It was my privilege to write a book about them, and I'm privileged to speak to you here tonight. Thank you so much.
Back in the 1940s, right after the war, New York was a two-sport town. There was baseball with the Giants in the Polo Grounds, the Dodgers in Brooklyn, and the incomparable Yankees winning pennant after pennant in the Bronx. And then there was basketball, college basketball, New York City's real game. On the streets of New York, people talked baseball. They lived basketball. And for a time, no one played the game better than a bunch of hometown boys from the City College of New York, CCNY. It was a peculiar mix, basketball and City College. City was an intellectual haven, the poor man's Harvard, identified more with providing a top-flight education than for fielding successful athletic teams. They're playing basketball.
All around the world. To the beach, y'all. Let's go. All around the world. Y'all know. This is so, so dead. To the beach, y'all.
Teams should be ready for any situation as it arises by being able to diagnose opponent's play.
He didn't dress like a New Yorker. He was a very sophisticated gentleman. He seemed to be an English aristocrat. And there was always the question in my mind, what is he doing coaching a City College basketball team? And that if they were to make it, he was the vehicle. He was going to help them.
Under Holman, City had been to the NCAA tournament in 1947, reaching the semifinals. Now his program was building towards something more.
What most identified the team was their ability to move the ball rapidly down court, to get an open shot, never to waste a shot, and to involve all five players on the court at the same time. Each of the players seemed to have a significant role. Irvin Dambrot was a left-handed shooter, and it was important that once in a while, when they couldn't break through a tough defense, he could open it up from the outside with a couple of left-handed shots. Al Roth was the guy who kind of controlled the ball with Cohen. And the two of them were a great backcourt, and they were able to see the open man. Norm Major would come in, he would give them a spark for 5 or 8 or 10 minutes. He wasn't afraid to get his body roughed up under the boards, to dive, to move himself around. Floyd Lane was such a cool player, such a guy in control of himself on the court. Eddie Roman, the center, was very strong, very smart, never seemed to make a mistake on the court, always knew where to be, was always in the proper position. Eddie Warner probably was as good a basketball player as played at that time, kind of late 1940s Michael Jordan. He could jump, he could rebound, and he had magnificent control of his body. He was able to fly through the air, drive to the basket, and he was physically very strong. And this was really the essence of City College basketball. Give and go, keep the ball moving, go to the basket, hit the open man.
Five New York City boys representing New York City's college, playing quintessential New York City basketball.
In my mind, I see it as a ballet. I see it as Guys and Dolls. I see it as Nathan Detroit. It was quick, in your face, a tease to the left when you knew you were going to the right. It was a magnificent acting out of the culture of the city.
This is Marty Glickman bringing you to Madison Square Garden, basketball capital of the world, where each year the greatest teams from the collegiate ranks battle for national honors.
In the first round, CCNY drew San Francisco, the previous year's NIT champs, and won easily, 65-46. Next was mighty Kentucky, and its morally suspect coach, Adolph Rupp. At the time, the Wildcats were more than the country's third-ranked team. They were basketball royalty.
Kentucky was the New York Yankees, Joe Louis, and Notre Dame in football. They were the defending national champions.
It was no contest. Slow-footed and bewildered, Kentucky couldn't handle City's quickness. The final score was 89-50. The worst defeat ever handed to a Rupp-led Kentucky team, and the greatest triumph in the history of City College.
After Kentucky, anything was possible. Anything was possible. Bring on Bradley.
City's 69-61 win over Bradley was a momentous achievement. It also presented Holman and his players with a unique opportunity. In just 5 days, again in New York, the NCAA tournament would begin, and no team had ever won both events. Playing in the Garden, in front of its home fans, City won its first two games and again found Bradley waiting in the finals. Now CCNY was one win away from the double championship. And as Holman told his team in his pregame speech, one win away from immortality. Seeking revenge, Bradley played City much tougher than the NIT championship game. But the Beavers had just enough left to hold off the Braves and won 71-68.
That's it. As City wins and becomes the first team ever to make basketball's grand slam.
How many things do you have happen in your life up to that point that are really that important? It was the most important thing in our lives.
City had accomplished the impossible. Classes were canceled, and the team and its coach were the toast of the town.
When City College of New York won the basketball championship, there was just an outpouring of affection for the team, of course, and for its very brilliant coach, Nat Holman. So let's hear it, New York. Here is
everybody shared in the victory. All the kids around the schools. It wasn't a victory just for 10 or 12 guys that played it. It was for everybody.
They had played stickball. They had played punch ball. They had played basketball when there was snow on the ground in the New York City parks. And now they were the best in the world. So the reflected glory meant so much to each of us.
This was a kind of vindication for us, for our parents, our ancestors, our way of life, for the streets of the Bronx and Brooklyn. It's not like they did it for us. It's that they were us and did it. You know, we did it. We can do any damn thing.
It was right that poor people could be given an opportunity for an education and an opportunity to demonstrate to everybody else in the country that people like us blacks trying to make it, Jews trying to make it, could make it. Could make it in America, that we were as good as anybody else. And that, to me, was and is America.
All right, and now, Mr. Lane, are you still open to sharing a few words with us?
Going to be tough. Words. I hope some words don't fail me. This has just been the greatest experience of ever that I could ever have had. We went, and being the competitors that we were, we had to face great things happening, we had to face not so great things happening. And I'm happy to say that my guys made it throughout the world, all their lives, they were who they were, a great group. And I'm so happy to have been able to been involved, to been able to have gotten my education, and I know I'm going to get straightened out because some of my instructors will be looking at me in here. My instructors will look at me and say, all right, let's get to your education now first. First things first, get on the ball. And it was so important at City College to get that education that we received. I was sure that I was going to follow Jackie Robinson on the Dodgers. I was getting prepared, and just loved it. Baseball was my game. I played it all over virtually the country, and basketball also. And I look forward. I never stopped playing, and continued. Baseball and basketball, and continued, and luckily continued to get my education. And from there, went to the Columbia University. First I got drafted in the service, and went to the Army, U.S. Army, almost 24 months there, and came back out. And wound up applying at Columbia Teachers College after I received my degree at City. And was fortunate enough to get a master's degree at Columbia. The young people here that are sitting here that are listening to what I'm saying, your education is vital, vital in your life. And don't stop. And be tough. A lot of tough being tough caused me to continue, stay with it, and get my education, get my degree, be able to get my master's at Columbia. And it's really a great, great feeling. And I love education, love young people. And I also, I did the community center work. And that was a wonderful thing for me. I must mention community centers because we had some wonderful times. I went to some great people, great youngsters. And of course, my pet of all times, Nate Tiny Archibald, as you all know him. And that has been the master, right up on the top there. He achieved everything that we hoped he could, and he certainly did everything that was so important in our lives. So I'm very, very fortunate to have had the young man and been able to teach him and help him go to areas that he wanted to move into. It's been a great life. It's been a great life. And being able to take good times, some tough times that came on. But if you're a real player, a real ball player, if you're a real competitor, you take the good times, the bad times, and you work with whatever you can do and try to help those whoever you can help. It's very, very important. That's the way I feel about it. So thank you all very much.